Welcome to another edition of My Family, our weekly broadcast dedicated to some of life's little lessons. In this week's episode, we find out what happens when an abundance of curiosity meets a lack of parental guidance. So remember, if you'd like to avoid life's sticky situations, pass along your values.
We continue our series on My Family, and today we're talking about transferring biblical values. A three-year University of Virginia study found four types of family cultures that's molding the next generation of American families. And it broke them down into four different groups. The first group it called the faithful. And this is 20% of American parents. They adhere to a divine and timeless morality handed down through Christianity and Judaism, giving them a strong sense of right and wrong. Raising children whose lives reflect God's purpose is more important to these parents than their children's eventual happiness or career success. In other words, they're raising their people according to biblical values. The second group are called engaged progressives, and that's 21%. They believe that morality centers around personal freedom and responsibility. Having sidelined God as the moral compass, they see few moral absolutes beyond the golden rule. In other words, this group of parents say pretty much, you can do whatever you want. The third group they call the detached. This is 21% of parents. They say, let kids be kids and let the cards fall where they may. This group of parents spend less than 2 hours a day interacting with their children, and to them, a family dinner together is off in front of the TV. The fourth group, the largest group, 27%, are called American Dreamers. They're optimistic about their children's abilities and opportunities. They pour themselves into raising their children and providing them with every possible material and social advantage. They view their relationships with their kids as very close and express a strong desire to be their best friends once their children are grown and leave home. And so you see, this study indicates the four types. One is the faithful. They follow by biblical standards. The engaged progressives, pretty much there's no moral absolutes. The detached, let your kids do whatever you want. And then the American dreamers, they're very involved in making sure their kids succeed in every way, not necessarily in growing in Christ. I want to ask you, which one of the four more closely represents your parenting style, the culture that you want in your family? You see, as Christian parents, we've been entrusted to care for and equip our children for life in the real world, and that is a huge responsibility. The question before us is, how can we establish and transfer biblical values that will guide our children when they leave home and venture out on their own? Well, let me ask you, think about your family growing up. What were the dominant values in your family as you grew up? Or what are the dominant values that you have in your current family? Would the dominant value be that we're going to put our kids first and make sure they get what they need? Or is it going to be we're going to get a good education so they can get a good career and make a lot of money? Or is the dominant value we want you to treat everybody with respect and kindness? Or is it always tell the truth no matter what the consequence? Or as a Christian parent, is the dominant value that you want to share putting Jesus first in everything you do? Because you see, your family is going to be the place, whether you like it or not, that your values are going to be communicated, and you will either do that intentionally or you will do that unintentionally. If you and I are going to raise godly children, we've got to learn how to prioritize our values and then communicate, model, and build those values into their everyday lives. Prominent theologian John Westerhoff has identified four levels of faith that everybody goes through, and he believes that these are the stages that all of us go through, no matter what age in our faith development, And I want to look at those four levels of faith today and put them in a biblical Christian context. Level one is the experiential phase. At this level, we understand God through the experiences of those that are close to us in our daily living. In other words, we watch our mom and dad. We watch our older brothers and sisters, and we learn from them. And one of the best biblical scriptures, I believe, on parenting is handed down to us in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy chapter 6. It says this, "Write these commandments that I give you today on your hearts." What's the commandments? Love God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Get them inside of you, and then get them inside of your children. Talk about them wherever you are, sitting at home or walking in the street. Talk about them from the time you get up in the morning or when you fall into bed at night. Tie them on your hands and foreheads as a reminder. Inscribe them on the doorposts of your homes and on your city gates. This is a powerful passage, and I believe it begins, first of all, it says, you got to get God's word inside of you, parents. Because if you don't have God's word in your life, how in the world can you transfer biblical values to your children? So once you get God's word inside of you, then you get God's word inside of your children. Now, this is tougher. How do we do that? I believe one way is you got to be intentional. You got to make an impression on your children about Jesus. And if you're going to be intentional, you've got to establish some priorities about worshiping, about youth group, about having prayer at meal times. You see, if we stop and think about this whole idea of establishing priorities, think of yourself of being a parent in one of three groups. Either you're a parent that prioritizes your values, or you make your values optional, or you totally neglect things and say, do whatever you want. Makes a big difference. Statistics say that today, 32% of millennials, meaning those ages 18 to 30, 32%, almost one-third of them, have no religious affiliation. Why is that? One reason could be is because they've left home and they're going to do their own thing. But another reason could be maybe they're raised by parents who did not make Jesus and church a priority. They made church optional. Do you realize today on all of our campuses, if we add them together and say how many of our children come every week, because that's the only way that we have to know who comes every week, on all of our campuses together, our families average going to church 2 out of 4 weeks. 2 weeks out of a month, so 2 out of 4 times our kids are involved in church. That's optional parenting. Isn't it interesting as Christian parents, if we have a job, we don't work 2 out of 4 days. If our kids don't want to go to school, we don't say you go 2 out of 4 days. If they're involved in youth sports or dance or gymnastics, we don't say you only show up for practice when you want 2 out of 4 days. But yet, isn't it interesting that we're Christian parents and almost every area of our life, we make it a priority. There are no options. And yet when it comes to putting Jesus first and going to church, we make that optional. Now, hang with me. Statistics show that if you make Jesus, church, and your relationship to Jesus Christ a priority, a very high percentage of your kids will also grow up and make that a priority. It's intentional. On the other hand, if you're those Christians that go 2 out of 4 weeks and you say, we're pretty committed, the problem is your kids won't grow up and stay in an optional category. Statistics show that your kids that grow up where it was an option, they will end up neglecting Jesus Christ and the church. So I want to say this not to guilt anybody out. I just want to share this. You need to think long term. And the decisions you make now, you must be intentional. What example are you giving your children about Jesus Christ and His church? If we're going to get God's word into our kids, we got to be intentional, because everybody else is intentionally trying to get their values into our kids. We also got to be informal. And that's what I like about Deuteronomy 6. It basically says to me that your values are caught as well as taught. In other words, your learning laboratory is everyday life. It says, look at your wake-up time, your meal time, your drive time, your bedtime. That's all a part of everyday informal living. Don't get them down and preach to them. Simply live the values and use life as a laboratory for teaching. And so how do you do that? Well, I believe you got to model your values. And you model your values by example and repetition. You see, when you walk the talk as parents, It gives you moral authority. If you don't walk the talk and you tell your kids, now you do this because I tell you to, you have positional authority, but you don't have moral authority. And I believe as a parent, you should never have a higher standard on your children than you have yourself, because you're not the exception. As parents, you are to be the examples. George Barna research indicates that 60% of learning comes from watching others that we trust. And so, moms and dads, if your kids trust you, they're going to be watching you like a hawk. Are you living out the biblical values? They got to be in you before they can be in your children. I want you to watch this video of an older couple in our church and see how their example, walking the talk, has impacted generations in their family. Listen to their story.
I'm Roy Hirschberger, and I'm 92 years old, and this is my wife.
I'm Darlene Hirschberger, and I'm 87, and we're married 69 years, December 2nd.
And then I always think of Genesis 2, 18. God said he'll make man, and instead I wrote in, he made Roy and Darlene for my mate. Well, I think the Lord will bless us by the family we've got. Four generations, they all follow the Lord's will and live a Christian life. And most of our family go to CCV, so that might be a good thing. Making the right choice. I'm happy to see that.
I think it's very important. You can't tell your kids what to do, but you live a life to show them that what Christ can do for you if you keep him in your life.
They just always have lived the life, and my dad always ushered in the church when I was a young kid. And when we moved out here, he was an usher of that church, and he's at CCV. When he started going there, they filled the bulletins on Fridays, and he's always been involved in the church. One of the real big things I remember as a kid, I was 16. We moved into town. I mean, he took over the gas service station in the city there, and they wanted him to have it be open on Sundays. He made a stand and said he would not do it if he had to be open on Sundays. And long story short, he was the most prosperous man in the community as far as his work as a station, working 6 days a week rather than seven.
Some of the things that I see in my grandparents that I really admire and respect with them is the fact that they never waver from their faith, no matter what the situation has been. They will never turn anyone down that needs help. They are major prayer warriors. If I ever have a need of prayer, they're the first people that I call. It is something that I want to be able to be like them in that area.
As an outsider married into the family, there is almost this sense of a little pressure of being involved in the Hirschberger family because of the great tradition and just the excellence of carrying on a legacy that followed Jesus. And it wasn't really anything that they said, it was just the things that we were able to observe and watch on a daily basis. And now our children that are in high school, junior high, and elementary, they're starting to carry on those behaviors that Roy and Darlene have modeled throughout their lifetime.
To be a Hirschberger, it means like to be like generous and caring, because like what I've learned from them is to always like give to others and like just be kind to others. They're just really good role models to like everyone in the family.
Oh, and I know I don't have too long to live, and I'm so glad that I accepted the Lord, and I'm ready to go too. But I like to wait a little while yet.
You hear that all throughout that video from generation to generation. Not that their parents, grandparents preached to them, but they walked the talk. They lived it, and that's what it means to be a priority. They were intentional in living their lives. My wife's family and my family, we were blessed. Even though we grew up 300 miles apart, our values are very similar, that if you were involved in her family or my family, church was always first. If you were going to stay a night at a friend's house, you had to make sure you're going to church. If you were going to go to a family get-together, it was always after church. If you were going to celebrate an anniversary or a holiday, it was always after church. If you wanted to ever play in a sports team, it was always after church. Church was the first priority, and they modeled that by example. You model your values by example and repetition. You see, repetition is what creates habits. Duke University researchers estimate that habits, rather than conscious decisions, shape 45% of the choices we make every day. Isn't that interesting? You say, well, you know, I went to church every week. You say, well, you're supposed to. You're a pastor. But my brothers and sisters go every week as well, and they're not pastors because that habit was instilled in their family. It was a value as they grew up. So level one is experiential. That's where you model your values to your children. But level two is association. And that's where young people seek belonging through groups. And that's why parents, it's our job to guide our teens into peer groups that are faith-based. And that's why I want to say it again, make sure your kids are involved in our youth programs at CCV on all our campuses, because you're hopefully getting them around other Christian peers. And each group has an adult that is a mentor or a coach to help them. Bible says in Proverbs chapter 5, mark well that God doesn't miss a move you make. He's aware of every step you take. The shadow of your sin will overtake you, or you'll find yourself stumbling all over yourself in the dark. Death is the reward of an undisciplined life. Your foolish decisions trap you in a dead end. This scripture talks about what happens when we compromise our character. It says your sin will overtake you. It will consume your life. It will control your life. It says you'll stumble all over yourself. Why? Because you don't have purpose and direction and focus in your life. And if you have a lack of discipline, it says you will make foolish decisions. You see, at level one, I believe you're more of a caretaker and you provide for your kids. But at level two, you're more of a coach. You're more of a guide. And this is the stage at what I think many parents are conflicted. My opinion, we can disagree and go to heaven. I believe at this stage, too many parents try to be both a parent and a best friend to their children. And in my opinion, those are conflicting roles. You can be a friend to your child, but if you're trying to be your child's best friend and also their parent, to me that's conflicting. I hope my kids like me, but if they don't, it's more important to me that they grow up following Jesus than if they like me. You see, you've got to make up your mind. And at level two, you monitor their values. At level one, you model the values. At level two, you monitor them through watching their friends and their influencers. Now, who are their friends? Those are the people they meet face to face. And so, moms and dads, when you're around your kids, look at who their friends are, because either they're going to change their friends or their friends will change them. So when you drop them off the youth group, who are they hanging out with? When you go to the school functions, maybe a football game, and you're sitting there and they get up and go away with their friends, what are their friends dressed like? What do they talk like? Who are they hanging out with when you drop them off at a mall? Who is it that meets them there? What kind of associations do they have? Secondly, who are their influencers? These are those they meet not face to face, but often as a distance through media. In other words, it could be Miley Cyrus, or it could be Justin Bieber, or it could be Tim Tebow, or it could be somebody else. Who is it that is their hero or they're watching as they grow up? You got to be alert to the influences of the world. Today, music is a number one influencer for the younger generation, or it's movies, or it's fads, or it's the internet. A recent Bitdefender study found that the average age of first exposure to pornography is age 11. Average age. In fact, they're finding that some begin watching pornography as young as age 6. The top web category that most children are interested in is pornography, online shopping, file sharing, gambling, and online dating. Moms and dads, you got to be aware of the influences in the world that are impacting your children. But hang on, whether we realize it or not, at this stage too and age, you as mom and dad are still the major influencer of your children, although often you won't feel like it. A Time magazine study found that 45% of teenagers today rely most heavily on their parents for sex information. 32% they listened to their friends, and 15% relied on what celebrities thought about sexuality. God help us, all right? So you better make sure as parents that you're talking to them, because they still value what you have to say. Level one is experiential, level two is association, and level three is the searching phase. At this level, they're ready to leave home and go to college. And your role begins to change from a caretaker to a coach to a counselor. And this is often a time of great stress for Christian parents. Why? We worry about what's going to happen to our children and to their faith when they leave home. The Bible says in Proverbs 13, intelligent children listen to their parents. Foolish children do their own thing. See, at level three, they're searching. And it's this level that they begin to challenge your values. And this is a time of testing and trusting. First of all, it's a time of testing. This is the struggle they go through. They say, wait a minute, did my parents really know what they were talking about? I believe my parents' values are old-fashioned. Will they really work for my generation? They're automatically going to test that. On the other hand, trusting is the struggle you're going to go through. Are you going to release them, or are you going to continue to control them? Studies are now showing that far too many children are entering adulthood crippled and unprepared to face life's realities because their parents never equipped them to handle life on their own. Right now, we're able to see for the first time the results of a first generation of over-parenting kids, better known as helicopter parents. Helicopter parenting sprang up in the era of baby on board signs, mandatory seat belts, and bicycle helmets. Joelle Alicia, writer for the NBC News, says, parents who continually intervene in their children's lives actually wind up producing children that are anxious, self-centered, and struggle with coping with the demands of life. They did research among thousands of families, and here's what they found. The more money parents spend on their child's college education, the worse grades the kids get. Aren't you glad you came to church today? I am saving you thousands of dollars. You know, they also found the more parents are involved with the selection of the college major of their kids, the less satisfied their kids feel with their college lives. Today, we find that many young adults are in touch with their parents constantly every day. There is this endless contact with parents that they never release their kids emotionally. And when children are not given the freedom to try on their own and maybe fail on their own, they never learn from their mistakes. Sociologist Michael Kimmel, in his book, Guyland, says that Guyland today is the world in which young men live. It's an undefined time span between adolescence and adulthood that can stretch on for a decade or more. It is a bunch of places where guys gather to be guys with each other, unhassled by the demands of parents, girlfriends, jobs, kids, and other responsibilities of adult life. The problem is they remain in this boyhood stage for years. Dr. Tim Elmore, a Christian author, has written a book entitled Artificial Maturity, and he says that today's 26-year-olds have the emotional maturity that 18-year-olds had a generation ago. They're physically mature, they're intellectually mature, but emotionally, they are stunted in their development, and they are literally 8 years behind what the generation used to be. Now, why is this all important? Because if parents don't learn how to release their children at this age and this stage, they'll never grow up. They'll never learn to be responsible, and they'll never learn to develop their own values and move to the next level. And the next level is level four, is owned. This is where they own their own values. You now have a personal faith instead of a parental faith. Now, this is not in your notes, but I want you to write this word out by the side of each level. Level one, write down the word caretaker. You're the caretaker, and at the caretaker level, you're constantly providing and protecting them. Level two, write down the word coach. You're the coach. You're helping them make wise decisions. Level three, write down the word counselor. You're spending more time listening instead of lecturing. As these teenage years, they are trying to search for their own values. And level four, write down the word confident. You're their confidant. You're a sounding board as they leave home, as they struggle with the consequences of their choices and their values. Proverbs 23 says, "Dear child, if you become wise, I'll be one happy parent. My heart will dance and sing to the tuneful truth you will speak. Don't for a minute envy careless rebels. Soak yourself in the fear of God. That's where your future lies. Then you won't be left with an armload of nothing." What's the key to transferring biblical values? It says to the younger generation, fear God. Don't envy worthless rebels. If you do this, your life will be overflowing. You see, at level four, when you own your own values, they develop their values. And those values become personal and powerful. Personal because it's your own faith. You know what you believe. You know what you value. It's powerful because then you know how to share your faith and you know how to defend your faith. Level four happens for different people at different stages and different ages of life. It can happen when your children leave high school and leave home and go away and face professors in college that don't believe in Jesus Christ. Or level four could happen when you go through a difficult crisis in your life and you say, what do I really believe? Or level four could happen when you visit a church that is different from the type of church you were raised in by your parents. That's why some people stay stuck in level three. Because you will always stay stuck in level three and never go to level four if your desire in life is to please your peers or your parents more than to please Jesus Christ. Because you see, when you own your own values and you know what you believe about Jesus, then you're not afraid to take a stand for what you believe. First person you must learn to lead is yourself. The first organ you must learn to master is your mind. The first value you must develop as Christians is your faith. So, what are we going to do with Jesus Christ? I read this week that studies are showing that the single most important thing you can do for your family is to develop a strong family narrative. In other words, what's the history of your family? The more children know about their family histories, the more they understand they belong to something bigger than themselves. Because when they know a lot about their family's history, they tend to do a better job of facing challenges. And so the research said, if you want a happier, more productive family, continually retell your family's best moments, but also tell about how they had to bounce back from the difficult ones. What's your family narrative? When I think of my wife's family's narrative, her dad had a lifelong struggle with crippling rheumatoid arthritis. When I dated her in college and went out to see him as a middle-aged man, his elbows had operated on, his fingers were going a different way, his ankles were fused, he had had knee surgery, he could barely walk, and yet for the next 30, 40 years of his life, I never once heard him complain with his pain. They ran a family grocery store in a small town, and I learned about the difficulties of doing that, how when you help people out and you give them food because they can't afford it, once they eat it, it's hard to collect. I remember about their family vacations. My wife would talk about that her dad is the type of guy that they would go down a road as a family. He'd say, I wonder where that goes, and they'd just turn and go that way. That's why she loves her dad more than she loves me. Because I'm the kind of guy that got to conquer the road and get there. Her dad took her fishing. They had great memories. Their family narrative was their leadership in the church. He was an elder. They sang in the choir. Her parents taught a young couple's class for years. And she always told me about the missionaries that visited their house. And when they'd come to the church, they'd end up staying at their house. And so she got to meet missionaries from all over the world. That was my wife's family's narrative. Again, we live 300 miles apart, but my family narrative was similar in some ways. We had some difficult things to overcome. My brother drowned at age 18, and we had to rebound from that. Growing up, I went to a one-room schoolhouse. We had no indoor bathroom. The Greek word for that is outhouse, in case you're wondering what that is. We had no family vacation for 10 years because times were tough. But I can think of great memories we had with sports as a family, with family get-togethers, and 4-H. My parents also were leaders in the church. My dad was an elder. He served. My mother played the piano every week for over 50 years. They were a constant encouragement to pastors. That is a part of my family narrative that's impacted my life. What is your family narrative? How did your parents transfer their biblical values to you? How are you going to transfer biblical values to your children? Because I want you to know today there's a war going on between the world's values and biblical values. And if you don't understand the difference, you can't transfer biblical values. The world's value is tolerance. The biblical value is truth. The world's value is affluence. The biblical value is generosity. The world's value is power. The biblical value is service. The world's value is appearance. The biblical value is character. The world's value is religion. The biblical value is relationship. So what's the takeaway? What I want you to do this week, I want you to discuss and develop four values for your family. I want you to do that. You say, well, I want to do eight. No, just start with four. Or if you can't do four, come up with two. But sit down and discuss this together, because if you want buy-in from your family, this is an incredible discussion topic. And once you discuss and decide, then write down how you're going to make those values a part of your life. You say, well wait a minute. How do I know even what those values are? Let me share you two or three values that were values in my family for our kids. Number one value, heads down, for our family was knowing and serving Jesus Christ. And so Jesus has always been priority number one. Our church has always been priority number one. Our kids know that's the most important thing. Nothing compromises from that, knowing and serving Jesus. Number two is building and rebuilding relationships. Because in a family, you try to build relationships, but sometimes things don't work out the way you want, and you got to work hard to rebuild those. That takes time. You got to work together as a team. You got to have to trust each other. The third value we had was developing godly character. We tried to tell our kids, you're special. You're the only one of a kind. You're unique and different. You're Wilsons. You're going to be different, but follow Jesus Christ no matter what you do, because it's important to me that my kids would grow up and stand alone and not be swayed by peer pressure. And to do that, they have to realize that they're developing character that honors God. Those were just three values that we had. What about you? Discuss together, develop, so that you can transfer those to the next generation. Because moms and dads, as Christian parents, our most important task is not to make money. It's not to live in a nice house. Our most important value as Christian parents is to transfer biblical values to the next generation. Let's do everything we can not to drop the baton, because if we drop the baton, we lose the race. Let's pray. Lord God, we love you, and we thank you for your word. Just the advice you give us in Scripture, that's why it's so important that we get your word inside of us so that we can transfer it to our kids. Help us to understand that we've got to be intentional, because the marketing values of the world, they're spending billions of dollars to impress upon our kids the values that are far from God. Lord, help us not to preach, but help us to live it, and just see that everything we do in life is a laboratory to teach biblical values. Lord, I pray for parents today and grandparents that did the best they could and it didn't turn out the way that they wanted. I pray that they would not leave in guilt, but help us to realize today we can put a stake in the ground no matter where we are, and we can say from this day forward, I'm gonna walk the talk. I'm gonna get Jesus in me, and I'm gonna do my best to get Jesus into my kids and my grandkids. Lord, I pray for every family on all of our campuses at CCV. Help us not to give up or give in. Help us live by grace and make a decision that we're gonna lead, and we're gonna do everything we can to transfer godly values to our kids. Help us, Lord. We need you and we love you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.